We're glad to have you in our service this morning. I know it's been a busy week for many of you here in Worth County. We started school back, and we are, you know, we've got a lot of folks involved in that, so we're glad that you're here. We have a special guest for you this morning. You'll be hearing from here in just a few minutes. We'll introduce her and Miss Daniel in just a few minutes, but she won't need a whole lot of introduction. You've seen her, and she's talked with us before, so I know that you'll enjoy the time that we have with her this morning. If you look at your bulletin, you'll see the things that we've got going on, things you need to pay attention to and be making plans for. You see the Sunday School Conference is coming up. That's the 22nd. It's just two more from yesterday, Saturdays. A wonderful time of instruction if you're going to teach and work in Sunday school over the next year. I encourage you to become involved in that and sign up and register and be able to go there. You see also that with the Pregnancy Center is going to be having classes at the end of the month. And so I encourage you, as we work towards opening that center here in Worth County, that you continue to plan for that. We're going to have a fun water day coming up the last Saturday of the month. It's from 11 o'clock to 1 o'clock. We'll have water slides and fun and hot dogs. Everybody's going to be invited from a child up to sixth grade. One of the ideas behind this is not the only idea, but one of the ideas, the kids that come to Vacation Bible School, some of our kids in the community, that's the only time that they come to our church or any other church. Now, some attend other churches, you know, in the country. Vacation Bible School is a rotation of kids. We all, to get a break from our kids, send them to the different Vacation Bible Schools. I mean, so that they can be instructed, we send them to the different Vacation Bible Schools around. And some of the other church kids, and they're certainly welcome to come. We'd love to have them come. But we're trying to reach out to those kids that don't go to church anywhere and get them back on our church property and get to love on them and hopefully be able to encourage them to come to church and so that they can come to know Jesus as their Savior. Or if they happen to know Jesus as Savior, they can grow and be all that they can be in for the Lord Jesus Christ. We'll be doing that again in the end of September. You'll hear more about that as time gets closer. This coming Wednesday night is our regular church conference and family night supper. Miss Debbie or someone for Miss Debbie will be standing at the back door. If you're going to be with us on Wednesday night, please let her know so that they can prepare supper for you. And then we will be taking care of the business of the church and electing our teachers and officers for next year. I didn't bring the list with me. That list has come along quite well. The one thing I see on the list that we're going to need to work on is nursery workers. Every nursery worker wants a break from nursery, and that's if you've gone back there and done it, you'll understand why. Probably the preacher needs to take duty every now and then. It might change his sermons if he would if he would go and stay with the kids for a while, and he might get through a little earlier. So the good thing about the preacher is I have short-term memory loss. I wouldn't remember it long. But anyhow, we need you to sign up, help in the nursery, and then any other place you see there on the list that needs to be taking place. Any other announcements that we need to make this morning? Any other announcements? I have some books in my office. I know where some of them came from. Don't know that I know where all of them came from. I've got a case of books that was written by Truett Cathy and in my office. If you left that case, please let me know that you're the one, Miss Debbie. Sure, before I went and gave out books and somebody didn't have them for another purpose. So we may have a study. I'll work on that. But if especially you've got a young son or whatever and you want to get one of these books, I got a case of them back there. It's better to build boys than to mend men. Of course, you know Truett Cathy was founder of Chick-fil-A and great man of God. So I encourage you to get that book. This is mine. You can't have it. I'll read it. But there's plenty back there for you to have so that you can read it. All right? Glad that you're here this morning. Let's spend just a few moments of fellowship. Okay. Please.
Just mentioned that Jerry Flint has been on our prayer list for several years now. He's a friend of mine's husband, and he passed away yesterday afternoon.
Yeah.
So he's been fighting cancer for several years now.
So quite some time, yeah. So please do pray for his family. Let's stand up, greet those round about you, and welcome to our service today. Thank you.
While the choir is getting their breath, I want to share a little something. I'm going to make it short because I know we got a long service today. Turn to 224. We're going to sing 224 and 225. And I got to get my breath too. The words of 224, we have come to this house and gathered his name to worship him. And I want to share y'all a short experience. And you know, Bruce tells his personal issues, and sometimes I tell mine. Sometimes I pray a lot, Lord, do you really want me to get up and say this, or I'm just going to get up and sound dumb? But a lot of times I sound dumb, so I think the Lord has laid this on my heart to tell me this. We come to church three times. We've got three scheduled times to come to church, Sunday morning, Wednesday night, Sunday night, and not in that particular order. But anyway, that's where we come. But this week at Flint Construction and Forestry, by the way, we've had a name change for some reason. Monday was Monday. Tuesday was Monday over again. You know, and it's not getting any better. And I've got mechanics pulling at me, and I got customers calling on the phone, and Mitchell knows what I'm talking about. And a lot of y'all do. I don't have the worst job in the world. I got a good job, really. And y'all have them days, you know, where Tuesday's a Monday. Well, by about 3 o'clock on Tuesday, I done had enough. The old light come on. I'd had a welder coming out and talking to me. I had a guy on the phone, and I had the parts manager come up. Well, I blowed up at the parts manager. That poor boy didn't know what was going on. He tucked his tail, and he went back to parts. And I just, you know, I didn't feel good about it, but I just blew it up at him. It wasn't his fault. It was just I had enough. And Wednesday went on. He didn't say nothing to me. I didn't say nothing to him. We parted our separate ways. I came to church Wednesday night, you know. And I don't know what was said. Either something Bruce said something or sharing with Christian friends or the prayer. I don't know what. But when I got through with church Wednesday night, I thought, I got to get to work Thursday morning and apologize to this guy. I really do. So I got up that early that morning, a little early than normal, fixed breakfast and lunch, and got to work. Well, I went on his territory. You know, men have territories, you know. Women own everything, but men, we have territories. So I went back in his parts house. I said, look here. There's no excuse for it. I apologize. I'm sorry I bit your head off. I hope you forgive me. There's no excuse. I can make all kind of excuses of how I got the world on my shoulders and all this. There's no excuse for it. He said, well, it kind of hurt my feelings, but I that's okay. I appreciate that. And we went on. Then Thursday got to be better, and Friday got to be better than that. You know, every day, as you close you get to Friday, it seems to get better. It's all a mind thing, you know. But what started that was coming to church. Now, what if I didn't come to church Wednesday night? What if I decided to sit home and watch the Boo Tube or go down to the barn and work? Would God spoke to me? No, he wouldn't. So that's why I'm saying, wherever you were Wednesday night, other than here, probably wasn't any more important unless you were at Banks Funeral Home or in the hospital, one or the other. Okay? So that's my testimony today, that it really did me a lot of good to come up here on Wednesday night. And I don't know what spoke to me, other than the Lord spoke to me, because he made my week a lot better. And I hope I don't have another Monday or a Monday-Tuesday when it comes up. But you got to watch what you say and what you do. So that's my testimony. And what we're going to sing when we come into the house and gather his name to worship him. So we need to worship the Lord this morning. So let's all stand. We're going to sing the first verse of 224. We're going to flip the page. Linda's going to have a couple of measures she's going to play, and then we're going to come in and sing all the verses of 225.
We have come into his house.
Bibles and turn with me to the book of Acts, chapter 1. Acts, chapter 1, go past your Gospels. You'll come to the book of Acts. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Acts, chapter 1, I'm going to read the first 11 verses. As most of you know, Daniel Gonzalez will be speaking with us for us in just a few moments. And one of the great joys that you have today as being a missionary is you can go to one place in the world and you can fulfill this great command that's been given to us in just one spot. That's not always been the case. I'll introduce her again in a minute, but I wanted to let you know the reason that I'm reading this particular passage this morning. Luke writes to us and says, "The former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after through the Holy Spirit he had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, and to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days, and speaking of things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, 'You have heard from me.' For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, 'Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel?' And he said to them, 'It is not for you to know the times or seasons which the Father has put in his own authority. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, in Judea, and in Samaria, and to the end of the earth.' Now when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, who also said, 'Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you unto heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven.'" Children of God said.
Amen.
Brother Robert Vogel, will you lead us in prayer? Kids that have book packs, you'll grab your book pack. And if you're here and don't have a book pack, come on down, because I know some of you are not school age yet. But all of you come and meet Mandy at the front.
We're going to talk about our lessons today, as our lesson today is about, you know, what do we do with all these new friends? If you have an opportunity, you want to show these new friends how much Jesus loves them, right? And do you know how you show them that? By kind of demonstrating how much he loves you. So you can talk about what you do at Sunday school and what you do at Wednesday night at church, and that your family reads your Bible together. Because the Bible tells us a real... I see that. That's good, Jordan. It tells us a good way to remember this. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, it says, "Be you an example of believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, and in purity." And that means as you go through your walk, as you go through your school day, you just show people that you love God by loving them back, by having nice words to say to them, by if they're having a bad day, putting your arm around them and asking them to play maybe in a different area with you, or if you have it recess, you can play with them during recess. And that's how we show God's love. So you know what? Okay, y'all listen, pay attention. What we're going to do, one way for you to talk to your friends and about Christ, but also to have a good school year, is to pray that you have a good school year. So every night before you go to bed, saying, "God, please let me have a good day at school tomorrow. Let me show all my friends how much I love you, but most importantly, how much you love us." So I've got this little cross we're going to put on all your book bags, and there's different colors, and I'll help y'all pick a color. But I'm going to read this word, this little prayer, okay? It says, "Thank you, God, for giving me a mind that can learn and a heart that can love. Help me stay focused and encourage me when learning is difficult. Help me to grasp the knowledge that is held out before me. Give me the wisdom to put my knowledge to good use and to build up the kingdom of God. Help me have the courage to follow your son, Jesus, everywhere I go. Amen." And this just means that you can count on God for everything. Just like you can count on your parents, and just like you can count on your friends sometimes, and just like you can count on your church, for everything you need, you can count on God, and you can help lead others to count on him too. Okay? So we're going to say just a really quick prayer right here, that you have a good school year, and that you can help to help others learn how to lean on God, and then y'all stay right here until I tell you to move, okay? So let's bow our heads. Dear Jesus, we just thank you for today. We thank you for this group of students, Lord God. We ask that you'll be with them, Lord, as they go throughout their school year, Lord. Help them to keep you first and to have the courage to follow you even when it gets difficult or we don't understand what's going on. Be with us. Help us be strong in your word. In your name I pray. Amen. Okay, now what I want all of y'all to do, I want everybody to stand up where they are and put your backpack on. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and let everybody pick a piece of candy, so we'll have that over with when we get done. Okay, stay in place. Don't move. One piece of candy. One piece, Ryder. Put one piece back. All right, here you go, Peyton. Y'all stay right here. Stay right here. All right, and parents, as you can, if you'll come forward. Here you go. Here, y'all. Pick a piece of candy. Stay. Come up here, Peyton. Stay up here, y'all. Stay up here. Parents or grandparents, whoever's here this morning. If y'all will just... Okay, here you go. And we're not, I'm just going to give you a color, okay? Peyton, So, no, stay right there. Thank you. any of our school teachers or school administrators, if you're here. All right, parents, I need y'all to, y'all are going to help me attach everything. So, yeah. I'll do yours. Okay. So everybody be really quiet while our parents are putting their crosses on you. It says any of our school teachers are up here. Okay. And I'm going to ask Mr. Roy Powell is going to come up and say a prayer for our students, for our teachers, and for our schools, that we have a good year and that we put God first in what we do. Extra crosses, so if y'all want to pick those up from me after church, that'll be fine.
All right, thank you, Mandy, and teachers and parents for bringing the kids. Again, if you have a child or you know of a child that was not here today and would like to have a cross, see Mandy, and we've got plenty more for that. Well, we had the pleasure about a year ago of having Danielle Gonzalez come. She was excited and anxious about what was going to happen in her life. She was on a new journey, going to the big city of New York City and help missionaries and be a missionary there. And so we got to hear about that. And this morning we're going to have to get to hear the rest of the story. Of course, there'll be more story coming after this too, Danielle. This is not the end of the story. This is the rest of the story up until now. And so Danielle's going to come and share with us this morning what's been going on in her life over the past year, what's happening in New York City, how you can be involved in that ministry, and she'll share a little bit about herself, too, in the process. So y'all welcome Danielle Gonzalez as she comes and speaks to us this morning.
I'm going to stand down here if that's okay with you guys. I feel a little closer to y'all. Miss Linda's going to run my slideshow for me. So I really just want to thank you guys for having me here and letting me continue to share my story and share what God's doing in New York City through our ministry and what he's allowing me to be a part of. It's really exciting. And so I do want to give you an update over what's happened this past year, but I do want to do a quick recap of the... Go ahead. And so year one... So year one, we were learning our community and focusing on establishing a core team. You can go ahead and go to the next one, and the next one, and just click through. So this is our area. Long Island City is in the yellow circle. We meet closer to the river, and the first year, like I said, we focused on learning our community, learning the rhythms of our community, just figuring out how our community existed when people were at home, when they were at work, because people in New York have really crazy schedules. And we were investing in our community, too. We spent time going to local coffee shops, becoming regulars at restaurants and barbershops and all kinds of things, just so that we could learn the faces and the people and the names of those that lived in our community, worked in our community. And so I could go on and on about that, but just for time's sake, I'm going to keep going. And then we also established a core team, and through that, it was our staff and then a couple people that we met in our community that were believers, as well as people from the Baptist Association. We had a core team of about 8 to 10, and for about 8 months, we met in our pastor's apartment on Sunday mornings. And it's just been really cool to see how those people have changed roles and engaged in leadership and taken further steps into leadership in our church as we've grown. And then I'm going to talk about year two. And we focused on expressions of grace. And the way we kind of tagline our church or describe our church to people in the city when we first meet them is we're a Christian church focused on expressing grace and peace to our community in New York City. And so we want to show grace and peace because that's what Jesus expressed to us. Like, he showed grace and he showed peace and mercy to us. And so that's kind of what drives us and drives our expressions of grace and ministry. And through that, we took what we learned in year one about our community and we kind of just put that into practice. Like, how can we meet the needs of our community? How can we be a part of our community and show grace? And one of the ways is by building partnerships and community partners throughout Long Island City and then different parts of New York City. And one of them is Our Children. Go ahead to the next one and just click through these pictures. And this is what they are. They are a ministry focused on reuniting women coming out of incarceration with their children. And they help them establish those relationships. They have some housing where they allow the women and the children to live and kind of like figure out how to be a mom and how to, you know, relate to their kids. They teach them things like filling out job applications, and there's also a food pantry. They help them apply for jobs and things like that. And it's also been a place for our church as a church body to go every other month on a Friday night, we'll go and we'll cook dinner and get to have a meal and fellowship with these ladies. And this is our Thanksgiving meal from this past Thanksgiving. And it was just really cool to see, you know, all the moms there and hang out with their kids and get to hear their stories. And, yeah, we've seen some of them come to church. One of our mission teams, they made these dresses, and we were able to hand these out to some of the girls there. That's our pastor and myself handing out some of the dresses, and they got to take two or three, and some of them, those are like the only dresses that they really have. So it's been really cool to see relationships grow at our children. And then the next one, just keep clicking through. They may be a little slow. And so the next community partnership is our Hunters Point Parks Conservancy. And basically, we have this huge waterfront park. And those of you that came, Miss Linda and Brim, on our mission trip, you got to see the park and got to work in our park a little bit. But Patrick, our pastor, he is on the board of the parks. He's on the parks board, and it has really opened up doors for us to share and really be able to get our hands dirty, and we have a lot of opportunities to pull weeds, and it's also allowed us to do our fun days in the park. And so we do things like face painting, and we do things like the parachute. We've actually been able to have our annual community carnival, and so in our parks, through relationships that we've built, and we don't really have to apply for permits, and they're just kind of like, okay, you guys do whatever, which is really huge because it takes several months to get permits. And our community carnival this past year, we had over 1,000 people come through. We saw some of them come to church, and it was just a really cool way for the people of our church to be involved and like really get to meet more of our community, and just to get to love on our community a little bit. And then a couple of our other partnerships that I'm not going to go too in depth into is Crew Inner City, and then Mythic Bridge and the Cove. And those are just ones that, again, it's just been really cool how we've been connected with them, and through people we've met in our community, they've been like, oh yeah, let me tell you about this partnership. You guys, you know, could do so many things there, and it's been cool to be able to reach people in the city and like just have conversations about the Lord through those ministries. And so I'm gonna go into year three, and this year we've really focused on discipleships and groups, and we really focus on our small groups. We put a lot of emphasis on our small groups. We really think that we really strive for those to be an area where our people can grow and like really be poured into individually. As you know, like it's really hard on Sunday mornings to get to know every person and get to know exactly how their week was going and how the Lord worked in their week and how the Lord spoke to them and how were they able to talk to others about Jesus. And our small groups really allow for that opportunity. They allow for they're discussion based oriented, and so we'll read a scripture and then we'll talk about what that scripture means and like how can we apply that to our lives this week. And it'll be the facilitator of our small groups asks questions that get people thinking and get people to dig a little deeper, and we really focus on being a community and being a family and getting to know each other on that deeper level in our small groups. And this past year, I've been able to step into coordinating our small groups, and I'll get into that a little bit later. So what else have we seen this year? These are just a few of our other pictures. Some other things that are really cool things that have happened this year. Oh, I do want to talk about this. These are four testimonials that people gave at the end of our spring small groups, and they were people that were highly involved in our small groups. Two of them were leaders. One of them was a host of our small groups, and they host them in our homes. We don't have a church building right now, and so people open up their homes and allow, like, our church to come in and, like, have small groups, and they, you know, sometimes they provide food or coffee or whatever. And so these are testimonials of how small groups impact their lives and why they felt like small groups were important. And it was just really cool to see these people that we've known for, you know, maybe 2 years that we didn't know. And some of them were raised in Christian homes, some of them weren't. And to see them move forward in their relationship with Christ and to see them want to help others do that as well was really cool. And so, go ahead. The next section is like, what else have we seen this year? We've seen, we had our first baptism service. We had 3 people get baptized, and hopefully these pictures will come up. But it's been really cool to see people. Like, we had a class initially, and it was, you know, what is baptism? Why do we do baptism? And Patrick, our pastor, he did a sermon on baptism and used some scripture from that. And then we had these 3 people come through. This is Chase, and he was not raised in a Christian home and has come to know Christ. And we saw him, like, chase after God, and he's leading a small group, and he is baptized, and he and his fiance are getting married soon, and she is well on her way to being baptized as well. We've had several good conversations with her about taking that step forward. This is Matt and his wife Gina, and they were both baptized that night. And Matt was raised in a highly Catholic home, and he was not a believer until after they got married. And it's been really cool to see the Lord working in his life as well. Another thing is we've had mission teams come, and summers are full of mission teams, and it's been really cool to see how they've allowed us to engage in our community and how they've opened up doors for us to reach people in our community. This is one of our Bible camps that we had. We had over 23 people come this year. Last year we only had 9. So it was really cool to see the group of kids grow. Some of them were the same kids that came last year, but only 3 of these kids were already associated with a church. And so it was really cool for us to meet their families and get to talk to their families and see, you know, how long they've been in our community and what their spiritual background is, and invite them to church. And then also we have had 2 of the ladies from our children come to church, which is a huge deal. They don't have cars. They have to use public transportation. They have to figure out how to get their infants on public transportation. This is my friend Karen's baby, and Karen is one of them that I connected really well with. And then Kelsey is another one, and the first time that she came a couple weeks ago, she prayed to receive Christ, and it was really just really cool to hear her story of how, like, the Lord, like, just grabbed a hold of her, and she was like, I felt like I wanted to get involved and, like, go to church, and she was in tears, and it was really beautiful to hear her story. And then this is our summer leadership team. Every summer we have interns that come, and they spend their full summer with us. They raise money so that they can come and serve with us, and these are some of our awesome interns as well as our full-time staff and our worship team. It was just really cool to see the Lord shaping us and growing our leadership team this summer. I want to talk a little bit about what I do. I have moved into being ministry advocate of groups, and that's just basically I coordinate our small groups. I coordinate our leadership team, who's going to host, who's going to lead. I get to discuss with Patrick what kind of curriculum we should do and, like, be involved in that decision, which is really cool for me. When I was first asked to move into this position, I was a little nervous about it. It's definitely nothing that I had done before, but it's definitely grown me and allowed me to be able to care for people and love people better and make sure that our leadership teams are cared for. And I'm not just over small groups. You can just click through these. I'm also over our kids group, so I coordinate our volunteers that serve in our children's ministry, as well as form our curriculum, and of course have my turn in the rotation of being back in childcare. And it's just been really cool to connect with the families of our little ones and get to love on them and get to love on their families. And then I'm also over our college group, and this is something that didn't quite exist last year. It was something that the Lord has laid heavy on my heart. College students, those were college years were some some of the most formative years of my life as far as being a believer. And I just know it's really important to reach kids when they're in college. And they, college students, just seem to have this this mentality of, like, just really, like, go and do and go get them. And, like, they really have a lot of potential. And I think it's just really, it's really cool to see Christ grab hold of college kids' lives and see them go through. This is a training that I was able to go through with some other college ministry people. The guys on the end work out on Long Island, and then the girls on this side work in Manhattan and Queens, at Queens College, NYU, Stony Brook, and Hofstra University. And it's just really cool to see how the Lord is, like, he's brought us all together and allowed us to, we're actually all friends outside of ministry as well. And it's really cool to see how God has, like, brought us together and allowed us to train and, like, sharpen one another to do ministry better, and to be excited about doing ministry. And so I do want to talk a little bit about where I do college ministry. I guess the first year that I was there, I saw LaGuardia Community College on one of my walks one day. Excuse me. And I thought it was really cool that we had a college campus right there in our neighborhood. And so, like, I tried for almost a year, knocked on several doors, sent a lot of emails, made a lot of phone calls, and phone calls weren't returned, emails weren't replied to. Oh, and if they were, it was, oh, I don't work there anymore, I moved to such and such state, I graduated, whatever. And so I was getting a little discouraged, and then I remembered that my friend Valerie works with international students at NYU, and it was, I prayed about it, and I was like, God, like, let her have some sort of in, let her know somebody on this campus. I was like, you know, there's a lot of college students in the city, but there's a lot of international students at LaGuardia. It's made up of over 20,000 students and over 110 different ethnic backgrounds. And so it's a huge description, kind of, or a picture of what Queens looks like. And like I was telling someone earlier, Queens is very ethnically diverse. There's a 7 train that runs straight through the middle of Queens, and along that 7 train line is little pockets of ethnicities, and as you get off at different subway stops, you can see the different ethnicities, and you can feel that it's very influenced by their culture, and there's over 800 different languages spoken along the 7 train line, and so this this college is a pretty good picture of what Queens and the rest of New York City really looks like. And so I emailed my friend Valerie, and I was like, hey, I've really been trying to get a foot in the door at LaGuardia. Is there anybody that you know? Is there any connection that you have, maybe? And she was like, actually, yeah, I know this professor and his wife and this student, and they're all Christians, and they would love to connect with you and love to have Bible study. And so I connected with them last winter, and we started with just prayer walking, and we had a mission team come in the fall, and we did a prayer walk through there, and we, as a staff, did a prayer walk, and then had a small Bible study afterwards, and it was really cool to see, like, you know, usually college campuses, you have to have a student ID or a faculty and staff ID. Really, this college, all you have to have is a state-issued ID with a picture, and so we just show our driver's license and get to walk right on campus, and nobody questions why we're there or anything, and it's just really cool to see that open door. Finally, and so through the winter and the spring, we met weekly, started with me and the professor and one of the students, and we met every week, and we did the same curriculum that our church small groups were going through, and then we slowly grew from us 3 to 6 by the end of the spring semester, and so we're on a small break during the summer, and when classes pick back up in September, we look forward to really starting back up again, and hopefully going to see some more students and more new faces come to that. And so, yeah, that is pretty much what I do. I do some other boring administrative stuff as well. So looking forward going into year 4, we're really, really excited. A lot of you know, a lot of you get my emails. We've been looking for and praying for a church space. Like I said earlier, we don't have a church building. We've been meeting in the community room of our pastor's apartment building, and we have to go down and set up every week. And so this, starting the beginning of September, we are moving into a school, and we're going to be able to meet in their auditorium, and our kids are going to be able to go into the cafeterias and we're going to be able to split that up and have different sections for our kids. That's really exciting, and we're really expectant in this time of transition to grow in numbers. But we're mostly excited about that because now we have space to grow. We were crammed into a little conference room with a giant table and six kids, and so we're really excited to see our children's ministry and our the rest of our church grow. And this is actually a picture taken from the floor of the school cafeteria where our kids will be and where our kids will meet. And so we're super excited about that. And then a lot of you know that since I've moved up there, I've been looking for an apartment. I've been looking for girls to live with that are Christ-centered and they love the Lord and that are also my age and not 40 or not high school or college, not high school, college. And so this is the apartment that I'm going to be moving into in September. And I'm super excited about that, and I thank you all that have prayed about that. I'm super excited about this next chapter of life and in our church. So I really just want to ask you guys to continue to pray with me, continue to pray for our ministry and our church and our pastor's family and the rest of our staff. New York City is a fun place to live, but it's also exhausting. And prayer partners are, they're vital. They're vital to ministry. And then also I would like to ask you to pray about it, to consider joining my financial support team. You can go ahead and click through. There's connect cards in the back where your programs were. There's connect cards. You can give me your email address. You can give me your physical address. And we can email back and forth. You can give me your phone number. We can talk on the phone, you know, whatever. And then on the back is where if you're praying about giving financially and connecting financially, on the back you can fill that out. You can hand it back to me. You can mail it to me, whatever. This is our church address, our church website. And then, Miss Linda, if you'll go back. That is our church address. And, like, if you want to send me anything, care package, a sweet card, you know, whatever. We love to get mail. We love to hear from people who are praying for us. It's really encouraging and helps keep us going. So, that's all I have.
Tremendous work that is going up there. Any way that you can be of help. Isn't it wonderful to see a young lady that has decided to serve the Lord in such a way? She's very, very talented and can do many things, but this is what she's chosen. Sometimes we're guilty as parents of saying, I want my child to be a doctor, I want my child to be a lawyer, I want my child to be successful in this, that, or the other. And those things are nothing wrong. I'm not chastising whatsoever. But I'll tell you, we ought to be thinking about how can my child be successful in the service of God. And when we do that, whatever field they choose, then they'll be successful. And if they don't, in eternity, it won't matter whatsoever. Danielle was very nice. She gave you just a general idea. I do know from listening to her and her mom and dad and talking, she has one need that's pretty specific. And if you want to help her with that, please do so. Her laptop has died. And if she's going to communicate with you by email and other ways, it's very helpful to have a laptop that is actually working. And so that's one of her immediate needs that she has. And anyone would like to help or consider that. You can do it a couple of ways. You can give here through our church if you want to get a tax credit for it. And then we will help Danielle with whatever funds that come in and whatever funds the church decides to help with then. That is certainly one way that you could do it. Or she's not going to turn down if you hand her cash. She will accept that cash and use it appropriately as God would have her to do so. So thank you, Danielle, for sharing. One wonderful time. If we don't do anything else on a Sunday morning, is that we must take an offering up. And so, Brother Charlie, if you will come, get our ushers, we'll take an offering.
Everybody take the hymn books, turn to number 330. We're singing one verse, 330, okay?
This morning to Nehemiah chapter 1. Let me do just a tad of vision casting for you, and don't get your mind off. I'm going to do a very brief opening, and then we will be done. I'm not going to preach for an hour and a half this morning. Well, as you turn to Nehemiah, wouldn't it be wonderful on a Sunday morning if one of our classes had the ability to connect with Danielle while she was doing one of her classes in New York City, maybe in a Skype session or whatever method we chose. There's several you could stream to do that, and those young folks could connect with some young folks here, and they could get an idea, because I assure you some folks that lived in the different places that Danielle's kids have been, they have no clue there's a place like Sylvester, Georgia. None. And we don't have a clue what their place is like, and the chances are the great number of folks in this church will never get to go to do that. But we live in the world, an age when you can make that meet. Now, here in this facility we can't. We don't have a good internet, or any internet really, here. But when we move across the street, we will have full internet access. And some of those things will be possible. So as you think, don't always just think standard box church, okay? We can think outside of that. And we can do outside of that. That's one of the reasons we're building a building with the capabilities it's going to have across the street. And so we may sit in rural Worth County in Sylvester, Georgia, but we can think worldwide and can do things. And I think it would make an impact on our students if they came to church one Sunday morning and they didn't just open up the standard, you know, quarterly, nothing against quarterly, standard quarterly, and read the few words out of it and do whatever. But if they were coming to church and said, I'm going to talk with somebody in New York City that might be from Bombay, India, or wherever, might have somebody in your class. And those kids might be excited that we're going to talk to somebody in Sylvester, Georgia that sounds funny and drops their G's when they're talking, you know, those kinds of things. So that is a possibility, and that's what we need to be looking for. We're not just moving across the street to get out of this building. We're moving across this street to reach, to care about folks, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, not just building folks. It's a ministry platform, and we need to see it as that. And then we could team up with folks. And Danielle's not that we could team up with them, but there's hundreds and hundreds across the world, missionaries. I mean, we could connect with a missionary in the Philippines or in any part of the world. There's things we can do, so we need to realize what we're doing. Okay, Nehemiah chapter 1, you can remain seated. I'll read the chapter for us, and I'm going to give a brief introduction, and then we'll be done, okay? The words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah. It came to pass in the month of Chesliah, that's the end of December and most, I'm sorry, the end of November and the most of December, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan, the citadel, that Hunai, one of my brethren, came with me from Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews who had escaped, who had survived the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said to me, the survivors who are left from the captivity in the province are there in great distress and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates are burned with fire. So it was when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned for many days. I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven, and I said, I pray, Lord God of heaven, O great and awesome God, you who keep your covenant and mercy with those who you love, you and who love you and observe your commandments, please let your ear be attentive and your eyes open, that you may hear the prayer of your servant, which I pray before you now, day and night, for the children of Israel, your servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which have sinned against you, both my father's house and I have sinned. We have acted very corruptly against you and have not kept the commandments, the statutes, nor the ordinances which you commanded your servant Moses. Remember, I pray, the word that you commanded your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though some of you were cast out to the farthest part of the heavens, yet I will gather them from there and will bring them to the place which I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. Now these are your servants and your people, whom you have redeemed by your great power and by your strong hand. O Lord, I pray, please let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who desire to fear your name, and let your servant prosper this day, I pray, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. Children of God said, we have not forgotten, or we've done with the series that we've been preaching on this year, man's rebellion against God. As a matter of fact, Nehemiah ties in well with the theme that we've been talking about, so I'm going to interject some Nehemiah over the next 3 or 4 or 5 months as we look at what took place here under the main character of the book, Nehemiah. We find that the children of Israel have been taken into captivity. This is the captivity that Nebuchadnezzar had accomplished some 80 or 90 years before the opening of the book of Nehemiah. I'll address more of that when we have time coming along. And Nehemiah is a very important person in the Persian kingdom. Persia is now what we know of as Iraq. And so he was high in the offices there. The Bible says he was the king's cupbearer. But he was also a Jew. And they had already been 2 returns to Jerusalem from the land of exile, from Babylon. And those 2 movements of folks that had gone back to Jerusalem had been able to build the temple back and restore some of Jerusalem. But yet, now Nehemiah finds out actually what was happening. Nehemiah was sitting in his service, and he overheard a conversation between two Hebrews in Hebrew, which was somewhat of an unusual thing to take place in the palace of Shushan there. And so when he heard the Hebrew language, the ancient language of his forefathers, he began to listen, and he found out that they had just come back from Jerusalem, and the situation in Jerusalem was dire. Yes, they had built the temple, but they had not been able to build the walls nor establish the security of the city in the form of gates, and they were being hard oppressed by the enemy. There were many in the land that did not want to see the Jews return to Jerusalem, and so they were doing everything they could in opposition to them returning. Nehemiah heard the condition, and the condition was desperate. As a matter of fact, if God himself did not intervene, there'd be nothing that he could do himself. He normally would not have been allowed to return to help personally, and the king would not have been too interested in putting much more money or effort in a faraway distant place that was laying in ruins. And so what did Nehemiah do? He didn't form a committee. He didn't get a group of folks together. He didn't wring his hands. What Nehemiah did, first of all, he saw the condition as it really was. And when he did so, it broke his heart. It affected his heart first. As you know from preaching we've done over the last little bit, I believe the number one problem today in the Church of America is we've hardened our hearts. We're no longer sensitive to the things of God. There's no longer tears in our churches. There's no longer hearts that are broken and concerned. And I want to tell you, if there's ever been a time that the Church of America and our church needs to be heartbroken, it's today. Our walls are broken down, folks. We may still have some churches standing, but our gates are unsecure. And the enemy is at full-fledged war against us. And there's nothing we physically are going to be able to do. We don't have that ability. But what we can do, we should do. I'm asked constantly, what can we do in this day and age? And my answer to that question is those things that we can do, we should start doing. And the first thing I believe we need to start doing is softening our hearts, allowing God to speak to us and us see the condition. Quit living with our head stuck in the sand, believing everything's okay. I'm not a doom and gloomer, but I want to tell you, folks, look around you. Everything's not okay. There is a evil world. The Bible says, for we do not fight against the normal things that you look at, but we fight against wicked spiritual things that we have to deal with in a spiritual manner. You can't pick up a club and hit what's causing the problems today. As a matter of fact, we're going to have to look in compassion on many of the things that are happening. So we're going to talk about coming up is softening our hearts. And I want to tell you, church, we need to soften our hearts. When our hearts become softened, then we begin to pray. What can we do? We can soften our hearts and we can begin to pray. I'm not talking about, oh Lord, help poor old me. I'm talking about repenting of our sins, repenting of our Father's sins, and getting right with God. And prayer may not be the easy, casual prayer that we've already been blessed to pray. Did you see what Nehemiah had to do? He said he prayed and fasted. Prayed and fasted. Now, I want to tell you, this preacher boy, you can look at him, tell him, he might have been doing some praying, but he hadn't been doing a whole lot of fasting. Don't laugh at me, neither have y'all. But I'll tell you, the times is serious enough, it calls for serious measures. We need to become a church that is no longer comfortable with the status quo that's been going on. And we need to begin to do everything that we can do to change it. Now, I've mentioned the three really key things we can start with, but there's more concrete things we can do. And we're going to be leading you to. We get sometimes discouraged because we look and the task is so great. I want to tell you, we look in our society and we can't change a lot that's out there. No, you can't. But I want to tell you, there are some things you can do, and the things that we can do, we must start doing. It's time. So I'm going to be leading you over the next several months on introducing things that we can start doing. You can do. Well, I can't go to Washington, D.C., neither can I. If I go to Washington, D.C. and knock on the halls of Congress, they're not going to listen to me. I can go knock on the president's door, he's not going to listen to me. I can go to the Supreme Court and protest, they're not going to listen to me. So what can I do? Well, it's time we found out what we can do and begin to do it. And we can start with the most important thing. That's a broken heart, praying and fasting. But I'm going to tell you, folks, we can do more than that. Get that right, and we can do more than that. We can change the world in which we live in. We can make a difference in your house. You can make a difference in your town. You can make a difference in your county. And you can make a difference in your church. Those are things that we can do. And those are things we must do. And that's what we're going to be getting ready to do and doing over the next few months and the year ahead of us. I pray that God would open your heart, that you would be willing to be sensitive to the voice of God, and you'd allow your heart to be broken. I want to tell you, folks, nothing's going to change until our altars are wet with our tears. Nothing. Father, speak to our hearts this morning. I thank you for this young lady that's come forward and served you and is continuing to serve you, and I pray you might strengthen her. Father, we need to be serving you right here. Not all of us are going to be able to go to the far parts of the world or even to cities beyond, but we need to be learning to do what we can do right here in this place. I pray this morning, Father, you begin to speak to our hearts. Challenge us to be more than we've ever been in the past, that we can serve you faithfully here in this place. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We stand and sing.